how this all started rolling around. How many people in this room remember George and Kay Robinson? Enterprise High School graduates in the 1930s. No? Nobody remembers the 30s? George worked for USGS, and they had a cabin up at the lake. And they had a son, Tony, who's an Episcopal priest in Seattle. And they had a daughter, Reagan, who was a librarian somewhere in, and she passed away this last year. Anyway, Tony has the family cabin up at the lake that's been there for 100 years. And last year, 2 years ago, he brought a guy named David Brewster in to introduce him to me and see the library. And David Brewster is from Seattle and started Seattle Magazine, if any of you Seattleites around here, and started a couple. Yeah, you know, okay. So fast forward, probably 6 months, a year after that, I get a phone call from New York and from this guy, Carl Rollison, who says that he'd met a guy named David Brewster who knew a guy named Tony Robinson who knew me. In fact, they'd both met me here in the library. And he told Brewster that he was working on a book about Walter Brennan. And Brewster said, well, I've just been to Joseph, Oregon, and there are a whole bunch of people out there know Walter Brennan. So anyway, we had a nice conversation on the phone, and he said he'd done all this research, but he hadn't met any of the family yet. And I said, well, I'll cut you a deal. You come out here and tell us what you've learned about Brennan, and I'll try to gather friends and family here at the Joseffy Center for you to meet. So he came out, and we had that meeting, and Darlene Turner showed up with her scrapbook, and the rest of you were in that crowd, and of course a whole bunch of Brennans, including Mike. And Mike's not here tonight, right? Is he coming? Okay. Well, Mike got really into it and took Carl out on a trip through the ranch, and anyway, made a good day of it. So Carl went back and wrote his book, and the book was published, and he wanted to come back out here, and we arranged this time, and we got in the way of Tammy's doing the Bloomsbury Run. Is that it? That your Bloomsday Run we're supposed to do? But anyway, she forgot that when we were setting up the date. But Tammy and Dennis and Peggy came down, and they toted in all of their paraphernalia here and put it up on the wall, and we had a good time putting it all up. And here we are. I think it's great fun, and it's wonderful to recognize Walter Brennan, and it's wonderful that so many people in this community still have memories or ties with the Brennan family and with Walter himself. So with that, here's the New Yorker. who doesn't have an accent, and accents play prominently in Mr. Brennan's life, I guess.
Absolutely.
But I told him, he said, well, how long do you want me to talk? And I said, well, I just came from an Indian meeting in Wallawa at the new Longhouse, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 hours. And those of you who've been to Indian meetings. But at any rate, he's going to talk, and I'm going to have this handheld microphone. Okay. And there will be opportunities for other people who have a story or a correction or whatever, right?
Right.
Kyle? Anyway, Carl Rollison, please welcome him, and it's his show right now. And then don't forget, the books are over here, and I'll introduce you briefly. Tomorrow night is the one-man play that Carl scripted and worked out with Kevin Cahill, who will play the part tomorrow night. And tomorrow afternoon at 2.
Thank you, Rich. I'm pleased that so many of you are here. And I will leave time for questions and comments and possibly corrections. That's certainly possible. Biographies are always open to correction. I don't know how many of you noticed that white Cadillac out there that used to belong to Walter Brennan. Is Mike here? Not here yet. Well, then I will say that we're going to offer that as a door prize. We'll see what Mike says about that. I'm a college professor, so that means we have to begin with a quiz. I'm going to show you some short clips from Walter Brennan films, some of which I hope you have not seen, but you can impress me if you have. I'm going to show the book trailer for my book, which is a kind of preview of coming attractions and an overview of his career. What's a book trailer, people ask me? Same thing as a movie trailer. Same thing, it's a kind of preview of coming attractions. And then I'm going to show you these clips from various films. Well, the quiz. Has anyone here, and you're going to amaze me if you've seen it, a film called Radio Doe, D-O-U-G-H, 1934 Columbia Pictures. Okay? Columbia Pictures then was part of what was called Poverty Row in Hollywood. It wasn't MGM, it wasn't 20th Century Fox, it wasn't even Universal, it wasn't a big major motion picture studio. It became quite important later. But if you were either an up-and-coming actor, or you did bit parts or extra parts, or what you were called a B-list rather than an A-list actor, you worked for these studios. And Walter Brennan worked for these studios for 10 years, between 1925 and 1935, before the first major production, really, in which he becomes noticed, which is called Barbary Coast. Has anyone seen that? 1935. I'm not going to show you a clip from that, but that was directed by Howard Hawks. And Howard Hawks often said that he discovered Walter Brennan. Well, not really. But he liked to say things like that because he was a Hollywood director. It was actually Ralph Bellamy. How many of you remember Ralph Bellamy? Yeah. Ralph Bellamy is the one who went to the producer, Sam Goldwyn, and said, you've got to take a look at this guy, Walter Brennan. He can do anything. And it's true. I think after I get through tonight, you'll agree that he could do anything. How many of you have seen a film called Fury? F-U-R-Y, stars Spencer Tracy. It was directed by Fritz Lang, German, famous German director who then came to Hollywood. It's about a lynching, not a lynching down south, not a lynching of a black man, a lynching of a white man, played by Spencer Tracy. And Walter Brennan plays a small role. He's a deputy, law enforcement officer. But he plays a modern, what I would call a new emerging modern type of the law enforcement officer who's aware of the power of publicity. And he is able to make himself in this film, the character that he plays, this deputy, into a major character, even though it's a minor role. And Fritz Lang loved that. He loved what Walter Brennan did. He was going to use him in even more scenes, and then Walter Brennan got sick. So he's not in the film as much as he should be. I'm going to show you a short clip from that. Fritz Lang liked Walter Brennan so much that he then cast him several years later. We go from 1936 to 1943, a film, let's see who's seen this, also by Fritz Lang, Hangmen Also Die. Anybody? Yeah, okay. It's the assassination of Hitler's sort of henchman, Heydrich, in Czechoslovakia, set in Czechoslovakia. And Walter Brennan, what does he play? He doesn't play a sidekick. He doesn't play a comic of any kind. He plays a Czech professor. Okay? That gives you a sense of his range. A German director who had his pick of European emigres in 1940s Hollywood. You know, writers and actors and all kinds of art, Marlene Dietrich, Thomas Mann, all kinds of people in Hollywood. But who does he pick? He picks Walter Brennan. Now, you may have seen Meet John Doe, famous Frank Capra film. Very important role for Walter Brennan, also a non-Western. My Darling Clementine, John Ford film, the only film he did for John Ford. And there's only one word for John Ford, son of a bitch. And that's what Walter Brennan would have said. Walter Brennan would not have called me on the carpet for saying that. He said, that's the only film I'm ever going to do for that SOB. Because he was terrible. Not just with Walter Brennan, with anybody. With John Wayne. He just treated John Wayne terribly. So you'll see a clip from that. Rio Bravo, that's a very late one, 1958-59. He's already doing the Rio McCoys. And he comes on the set limping. And Howard Hawks looks at him, and again, excuse my language, but this is the way Hawks talk. He said, you're not going to do that Rio McCoy shit for me, are you? And he turns to John Wayne, and he says to him, he said, Duke, let's go get a drink or something while this dumbbell, meaning Walter Bennett, figures out what he's going to do with this part. And he plays the part of Stumpy. I was very fortunate. I interviewed Angie Dickinson, who's in Rio Bravo, about Walter Brennan. She admired him. She just thought he was a great actor. And I'll just say it right now. I think he's the greatest actor in the character actor in the history of Hollywood. There just isn't any better. He's in over 200 films. And again, tremendous range. Now, I'm going to show these clips in a minute. Come on. Okay. Walter Brennan might have appreciated this. This is a Norman Rockwell painting, and I never thought my publisher would use it, even though I thought it was the perfect cover. Why? Because I thought it was Norman Rockwell. It's going to cost a fortune. And this is the University Press of Mississippi. They don't have a lot of money. They pay maybe tops $450 for a cover. I know, because I'm doing another book with them, and that's as much as they'll pay for the photograph I wanted to use. Fortunately, even though it's a Norman Rockwell painting, it was commissioned by the National Cowboy and Western Heritage Museum in Oklahoma City, where Walter Brennan was inducted into the Hall of Fame, Cowboy Hall of Fame. And he left all his papers there. That's where I have to go to look at his papers as well. And I think they paid Rockwell maybe $5,000 commission, something like that, for the painting. And I was still worried that because it's the cover of a book, that the Cowboy Museum was going to just charge a fortune, and I wouldn't be able to use the cover. And it turns out that they charged my publisher $25. Oh, Walter Brennan would have loved that story. He would have loved that story. He loved deals. He loved that kind of thing. He'd say, good for you. Sorry you wrote the book about me, but good for you anyway. I said, yes.
That picture, when it was printed, my mother,
yeah. Yeah, that's what it looks like. I'm going to play this book trailer. It's only 2 minutes. Yeah. Mike doesn't look any different. I do, but he doesn't. Radio Dough. Now, this is just amazing. This was done in 1934. Nobody knew who Walter Brennan was. He's not even in the credits. There we go. Thank you. You haven't missed anything, believe me.
Gary, you'll be a fashion plate when I get through with you. Here, slip your arm in this.
Doesn't matter what he's saying, just watch. He's not even credited in this. You won't find his name in this film. This is something Buster Keaton would do. It's just as good as Keaton.
That is swell. It's beautiful, yes. But I don't like it. You get too many buttons on.
Too many buttons, he says. That's it. That's his bit. That's what a bit player did. But he's better than most. Better than anybody, I'd say. Here's Fury.
Stop your motor, buddy. Get both hands up on that wheel there.
What is this, a holdup?
You wasn't letting any grass go in them tires, was you?
I wasn't speeding.
An Illinois license plate, huh?
Yeah, sure, Chicago.
Get that fist up there.
Hey, I haven't got any gun, if that's what you mean. Peanuts won't kill you, will they?
Solid peanuts?
Yeah, why?
I ain't answering the questions, buddy. You are. Come on, get out.
Where were you last night, Mr. Wilson? If you don't mind.
I drove all night last night.
On that old road?
Well, I got lost trying to find a shortcut to Capital City.
And the night before last?
Camping out.
Sorry to take up so much of your time, but excuse me a second. Smoke?
No, thanks.
That's why they want the peanuts.
Some peanuts?
Well, now you're talking my language, Sheriff. I've had that habit ever since I was a kid. My old man used to bring them home to me. I got kind of used to having them around.
He was often used for the reaction shots. He was as important in the scene as the major actor was, because he was really focusing the action. He's all of a sudden perked up here.
Yes, sir. Always find peanuts in my pocket.
Wilson? Where did you say you spent the night before last?
Camping out.
Why?
Why? For the... Hey, is it a crime to get some fresh air for yourself when you've been stuck in a... Hey, look. What am I suspected of anyway? I got a right to know.
Sure.
Me? Well, that's the craziest thing I ever heard. That'd fit a million men.
Read that.
Hey, am I the only guy in the world that eats peanuts? Why,
I never ate peanuts in my life.
Oh. I get it. Well, why don't you check up on me then? Get my brothers on the phone.
Now, look at this. The way Lang uses him here in this scene. Watch what happens.
On in Chicago, they'll tell
you. We'll check, all right. That's what I'm here for. Mind showing me what you got in your pockets here?
I should say not. I don't mind. I mean, he knows what I got. Some keys, handkerchiefs, a license, money, what there is of it, pipe, tobacco, matches, and peanuts.
Bud.
Quiet, Rainbow.
Check those bills against the numbers of these ransom banknotes.
You come to the right man, Chief.
Sure, he's only going to check those, Sheriff.
You're probably right as rain, Wilson.
Hey, take a look at this under the $5 series here. Q4967738Z. And on his bill, the same thing. Q4967738Z.
Oh, but that can't be, Sheriff. That's impossible.
Rip up that car of his. Might be more of them hidden there.
Man, is this going to be a sensation?
Keep it to yourself.
When he says that, man, this is going to be a sensation. I don't have the other clip to show you. There's a barroom scene in which the deputy just gets off on being the center of attention. They think he knows something, that he's going to give them the inside information. Lang was one of the first people to understand what was happening in terms of the media, how a nobody could suddenly become somebody because of the position he was in, because of his access to law enforcement. Suddenly, this minor, in a sense, character actor here, also character, gets blown up out of proportion. And that's when Lang saw, wow, I can do something with this guy. And that's, you know, several years later, he casts him as this Czech professor.
And keep that door quiet.
Very famous speech from Meech Trudeau.
Okay, fellas, now let me see. You sit outside the door. Nobody comes in, see. You two fellas sit in here.
Hey, pretty nifty, huh? You ain't gonna get me to stay here.
Sure you are.
No, sir. That spot under the bridge where we slept last night's good enough for me.
Say, what'll I do with this baggage?
Well, stick him in the bedroom.
Give me mine. I ain't staying. You know, we were headed for the Columbia River country before all this John Doe business came up. You remember that, don't you?
Brennan plays a character called the Colonel. Just kind of funny, because he's really a kind of anarchist.
Sure, I remember. Say,
you know Gary Cooper? He plays this baseball player. He's got an injured arm. And Barbara Stanwyck convinces him to be John Doe, this guy who says, you know, I'm going to jump off a bridge. Life isn't worth living. Politicians are, you know, cynical and corrupt. Ever hear that one before? You ought to watch this film. It tells you a lot about what's happening today.
Here's Pop coming up in the elevator. Mind it.
All along, John. I tell you, it's no good. You're going to get used to a lot of stuff that's going to wreck you. Why, that $50 in your pocket's beginning to show up on you already. And don't pull that on me, neither.
Stop worrying, Colonel. I'm going to get my arm fixed out of this.
Hey, here's some cigars the boss sent us. Have one.
Hey, cigar.
Help.
Say, I'll bet you even the major leaguers don't rate an outfit like this.
Here, make yourself comfortable. Paper?
Yeah, I don't read no papers, and I don't listen to radios either. I know the world's been shaved by a drunken barber, and I don't have to read it. I've seen guys like you go under before. Guys that never had a worry. Then they got a hold of some dough and went goofy. The first thing that happens to a guy...
Hey, you got a load of the bedroom. No.
The first thing that happens to a guy like that, he starts wanting to go into restaurants and sit down at a table and eat salads and cupcakes and tea. Boy, what that kind of food does to your system. The next thing the dope wants is a room. Yes, sir, a room with steam heat and curtains and rugs. And before you know it, he's all softened up and he can't sleep unless he has a bed.
Hey, stop worrying, Colonel. $50 ain't gonna ruin me.
I've seen plenty of fellas start out with $50 and wind up with a bank account.
Hey, what's the matter with a bank account anyway?
And let me tell you, Long John, when you become a guy with a bank account, they got you. Yes, sir, they got you.
Who's got him?
The Helots.
Who?
Helots.
Hey, there's the City Hall tower I was supposed to jump off of. It's even higher than this.
Who's got him?
The Helots.
Woo! Hey, wait a minute! You're not supposed to jump on Christmas Eve. Do you want to get me in a jam?
If it's going to get you in the jam, we'll do you a favor. I won't jump.
And when they got you, you got no more chance than a road rabbit.
Hey, who'd you say was going to get him?
Say, is this one of those places where you ring if you want something?
Yeah, just use the phone.
Boy, I've always wanted to do this.
Hey, Doc, look. Look, Doc. Give me that again, will you? Who's going to get him?
The Helots.
Who are they?
Listen, sucky, you ever been broke?
Sure, mostly often.
All right. You're walking along. Not a nickel in your jeans. You're free as the wind. Nobody bothers you. Hundreds of people pass you by in every line of business. Shoes, hats, automobiles, radios, furniture, everything. And they're all nice, lovable people. And they let you alone. Well, is that right? Then you get a hold of some dough and what happens? All those nice, sweet, lovable people become helots. A lot of heels. They begin creeping up on you, trying to sell you something. They get long claws, and they get a stranglehold on you. And you squirm, and you duck, and you holler, and you try to push them away, but you haven't got a chance. They got you. First thing you know, you own things. A car, for instance. Now your whole life is messed up with a lot more stuff. You got license fees, and number plates, and gas, and oil, and taxes, and insurance, and identification cards, and letters, and bills, and flat tires, and dents, and traffic tickets, and motorcycle cops, and courtrooms, and lawyers, and fines, and a million and one other things. And what happens? You're not the free and happy guy you used to be. You got to have money to pay for all those things. So you go after what the other fellas got. And there you are. You're a helot yourself.
That's one of the great movie speeches. You don't get speeches that long in a movie. It's just tremendous. The whole thing. Here's a short one. Don't miss it.
Stop, Paul! Stop, Paul! Stop!
Now!
When you pull a gun, kill a man.
Yes, Paul.
My Darling Clementine plays Old Man Clanton, a tremendous, tremendous villain. Shows you something about his child raising. Mrs. Hangman also died. It's the book trailer. That was the Czech professor, played with such dignity, so different from the other roles. You ask yourself, how could Fritz Lang feel, the guy who played the deputy in Fury, do this? But he knew he had it in him, that he could do something completely different, a straight dramatic role. He's part of an underground anti-Nazi movement.
Professor Novotny, whom are you looking for?
For you.
No.
Executions will cease the moment the case is finished. Not before.
You know what will happen to you if you lie.
Yes.
Just that shot there of, again, what Brennan represents in the film is decency, democracy, everything that the Nazis are against. Let me move on here.
Two of them made it to that shack.
Rio Bravo.
If we cross that creek, we'll be in bad shape. Now get behind us.
I don't know how we're going to stop them from here.
Is that who I think?
Old Stumpy. Fellow I left behind.
He's played the whole film, if you've not seen the film, in the jail, essentially in the jail. He's not incarcerated in jail. He's John Wayne's sort of assistant. And he's kind of like Eddie in To Have and Have Not. I could have showed you a clip of Eddie. A disabled person who ends up in both films being a kind of hero in a very interesting way.
Hey, Senor Chance, don't shoot, it's me.
Carlos, what are you doing here?
I bring you some more shells. You might need them, senor.
Turn up next.
Maybe the girl in another flower pot. Hey, Chance, don't be sitting in a bad place. That wagon's got dynamite in it.
I go tell him, senor.
You stay here. I'll go get him. Give me those shells.
It's a good one.
You got a good seat, all right. That wagon's full of dynamite.
Jumping Jehoshaphat. Why don't nobody never tell me nothing?
Brennan took out his teeth for this one. You know, he always asked, how do you want me to play this, with my teeth or without my teeth?
Get away from that wagon or you won't be around to hear anything.
Here's the hero. He's in a big shootout, right? And he's worried because Stumpy's next to the dynamite. Watch what Stumpy does.
Stumpy, hurry up. What are you doing?
What do you think I'm doing, taking a siesta? I brought some dynamite.
It's a good idea. Let's get farther away from that wagon.
Can you shoot as good as you say, Jim?
Can you throw?
Near as far as you can shoot.
Find out. Get that box open. Dude! Over here!
Get ready!
Let it go!
That was a good one.
So you get the idea. Stumpy saves the day. He constantly did variations on these kind of sidekick roles, but he was much more than that. That was Rio Bravo, the last one. Now I want to turn off the sound because I want to say a few things about these films. Three Godfathers. Has anyone seen Three Godfathers? You might call it a spiritual western. It's been made it four times. John Ford made it. William Wyler made it. This is the best version. This was a film directed by Richard Boleslavsky, who before there was method acting, he was a method actor. He came from Europe. He was one of these emigres to Hollywood. Walter Brennan loved the guy. He said when Richard Boleslavsky died, and Boleslavsky died maybe a year or two after this film was made, Brennan said it was like his father dying. He just had such rapport with this director. He's in this film with Lewis Stone. You might remember him from the Andy Hardy movies if you're old enough to remember that. Chester Morris is in this film as well. And they play these three desperados, these three bank robbers, who end up adopting a baby. And actually, they die trying to save these babies. Chester Morris just makes it back to the town they robbed to deliver this baby. It's a fantastic movie. It was one of Walter Brennan's all-time favorites. There he is, his old man, Clanton. Clanton is looking out there. He knows he's going to die. He knows Henry Fonda's going to kill him. Wyatt Earp. There's Jimmy Stewart. Far country. There's Rio Bravo again. There's, as I said, when some of you were first coming in, Walter Brennan's first acting role as a baby. You know where he was born? Lynn, Massachusetts. And then he grew up in Swampscott, Massachusetts. He drove a delivery wagon. He was around horses very early, even though he wasn't a Westerner to begin with. He was not the family's favorite. His mother, they had an older son who was supposed to be the star. Walter was a ne'er-do-well, got kicked out of high school. He was sent to a technical school in Cambridge. He was interested in vaudeville. He was interested in performing. He would bring home characters that he'd pick up on the street and give them a meal at home. It didn't matter where he was. He could be in Hollywood, and he could see a guy. He could watch somebody sweeping a floor, and he'd go up to, he did this. He went up to a floor sweeper, and he said, I want to know what you're thinking about as you're sweeping the floor. And the guy says, why do you want to know? He said, I might have to play a floor sweeper sometime. I mean, he watched everything. He was just intensely curious about people. But he saw action. He did some performing when he was in the military, but he was gassed. He eventually went into shell shock several years after the war, actually, in the 30s. He didn't talk about it, but he was in the major American battles of World War I, three of them. There he is when he first got married. That's his first big role, of course. Look at how thin he is. He said he was so thin. He was just coming out of this period where he was having what you'd call a nervous breakdown, really. He said they had to sew muscles into his clothes. That's Joel McRae. That's Eddie Arnold, Edward Arnold. He's playing a Swede here. And his makeup and a lot of the way he looks here, he looks a lot like his father, and he did that deliberately. When his mother saw it, his father just died when this film came out, and his mother saw it, he said, you know, yeah, that's your father. His father was an engineer. Mike can tell you about this. He created several patents, which unfortunately he did not put his name to. This is Banjo on My Knee. Now, this film interests me intensely. Brendan does not play any of the instruments, but you could swear he does. And he plays someone like 30, 40 years older than he was then. He was still in his late 30s when he did this film, early 40s. And he was in it with Buddy Epson. Anyone remember Buddy Epson? And Buddy Epson said, gee, that was great. When they wrapped the film, he said, I'll see you at the Academy Awards. And Walter said, I'll see you, but you won't recognize me. Buddy said, what are you talking about? So Buddy Epson went some months later to the Academy Awards, and a guy came up to him and says, hi, buddy. Epson looks, they said, do I know you? He said, is Walter there? Because he would completely transform himself for these parts. It was more than makeup. He wasn't a method actor. He never had an acting lesson in his life, but he would say things like, if I'm playing an old man, I have to stay in character all the time. If I go to lunch, I go to lunch as the old man. Because if I don't go to lunch as the old man, when I get back on the set, it's going to take me forever to get back into those mannerisms and so on. He did another film, Joe and Ethel Turk Beat the President, a film that probably nobody has seen, in which he plays a person his own age, and he was worried. He said, you know, I hope some of my mannerisms might, and there was this young actress, and he went up to her and he said, will you watch me? He said, if I start to fall into certain mannerisms and stuff, would you tell me? And she said, God, you know, this is a guy that's already won two Academy Awards, and he's telling me to, you know, point out his flaws. I mean, that's what he was like, just a thorough professional and artist. Oh, the other reason I'm interested in this film, by the way, is I'm writing a biography of William Faulkner, and he was assigned to this film because it's set down in the Mississippi riverfronts, and he knew these people. Eventually, they took him, like Hollywood does, they took him off the picture, but he had an important role to play here. Oh, it's a wonderful film, The Buccaneer. This is Cecil B. DeMille, and he plays this character named Ezra Peavy, who's always telling off Andrew Jackson. This is hilarious. This is Northwest Passage. Now, this is not one of Walter Brennan's great roles because they didn't give him enough to do. He begins the picture in the stocks, and you think, God, he's going to be this wonderful, you know, outlaw sort of character. But the script doesn't doesn't carry that through. This is Stanley Livingston, but it's very similar to what he does in Northwest Passage, too. There are some roles, he said, if the writing's not there, I can't do them. There's Northwest Passage. I got ahead of myself. Now, Tracy showed up about 20 pounds overweight with a box of chocolates. And he was playing Rogers of Rogers Rangers. Not my favorite film. I just do not believe him as one of the Rogers Rangers. Walter Brennan is quite good as one of the Rangers. They served them powdered eggs. Tracy threw them on the ground, and the food improved after that. Meet John Doe. There's Edward Arnold again, Barbara Stanley. He plays a wonderful part here, a preacher. What's his name? Just suddenly escapes me. But it was an actual, this is Sergeant York, Gary Cooper, and this is his spiritual advisor, this preacher. He's got to wrestle with his conscientious objection, whether this is made in World War II, but it's about World War I, about Alvin York, a much decorated war hero. And Walter was very worried. Because the man was alive, he wanted to do it justice. And I don't know if you know this, but Walter was quite a devout man. And he really wanted to do justice to this, and I believe he did. And so did the real-life model, who had never seen a movie until they made Meet John Doe. Pastor Pyle, thank you. Yeah, I'd forgotten. Pastor Pyle. Yeah. They're about the same age. He always played. Gary Cooper played characters a good 10 years younger than he actually was. Like when you see him in Sergeant York, he's really a little old. Yeah. Yeah. Just like people are always amazed when they know, what was he, 6'2", 6'3"? And they're surprised because he's so often in his play, in his roles, bent over. This is a wonderful film. This Woman Is Mine, that's Franchot Tone. I've forgotten the actress's name. This was made right after Mutiny on the Bounty. I would say he's right up there with Charlton Heston. Charles Lawton, sorry. He plays a very strict, oh, that's wonderful too, Princess and the Pirate. He has the hots there for Bob Hope. Goodbye, My Lady, one of his favorite films, and of course, The Real McCoys. When they did rehearsals the first time, nobody thought this was going to be a hit. Who wants to, watch these Beverly Hillbillies? And then, of course, there are the Beverly Hillbillies. I mean, there are all kinds of, spin-offs from the original Real McCoys, it started out slow, but by the third or fourth episode, it was a real hit. But if you look at the original reviews of Variety, they're saying things like, who wants to watch these hicks? Who? I did. I watched it as a kid. I loved it. And why did I love it? Partly because it's an extended family, as mine was. My grandparents lived at home with me. It didn't matter that they were from West Virginia. Their problems were real problems, problems I could identify with. What really floored me was when I read Richard Crenna's account of lecturing in Indiana, and some black students came up to him and they said, tell us about Walter Brennan. Did he really have a limp? No, he didn't really have a limp. And then they began to tell him that Walter Brennan was one of their favorites. Why was Walter Brennan one of their favorites? He said, because TV, they said in the 50s, they had all, Ozzie and Harriet, we couldn't relate to these people. What did that guy even do for a living? I mean, it made no sense to them. But Walter made sense to them. That was real. They really believed that. He took one look at Kathy Nolan, though, when they were rehearsing. All the actors were rehearsing, and they were trying out the accents. What was this accent going to be like for these characters? It just sounds like they are those characters. But no, they have to think about, how is everyone going to sound? And they went around the table. When they got to Kathy Nolan, she began to speak her lines. And he went, follow her. Walter said, follow her. She was just a young actress. She hadn't really done much. And for Walter Brennan to say, follow her, was just overwhelming. She said, you know, it made her career, it made her life. It was just so wonderful of him to say that. Always brought his own lunch. He hated the lunch that they fixed. Tycoon, Mike can tell you about this series. They kind of pulled the plug on this fast because people weren't used to him in this kind of role, even though in many ways he was a tycoon. He was a businessman. And he certainly played this role very well. That's from the Guns of Will sonnet. Very poetic Western. Over the Hill Gang with... That's Fred Astaire there. You see him? There he is. Delighted to be in a Western. He has range too. Red River, of course. Very, very famous film. One of the greatest. Now here he is with his family, his parents. There was a daughter who died in infancy. Just a few days old. I've forgotten how old. And I'm not sure everybody even knew that, but when I looked up the records, I saw that that was true. That's Walter, of course. This was supposed to be the family success. No way. This was the family success. But it was not expected. Eventually, he brought his New England parents out, bought them a home. They lived in Pasadena. Right after they were married. You see how thin he is there. There's the father. And he does, kind of looks like that character in Come and Get It. Mike says that's him in the middle. I'll take his word for it. So that must be Ruthie. Yeah, and that's Andy. And that's, do you remember the name of the dog? I don't think we ever... Loopy. Oh, yeah, yeah. This is Ruthie, and she appeared in a number of pictures before she got married. He felt she had some real talent, but she decided to get married and gave up acting. And he's playing a Russian peasant here. This is where I first got to know Walter Brennan, because I was working on Dana Andrews. And Walter Brennan appears in the North Star, and also in the Westerner, Dana Andrews has a very small role. It's his first motion picture. But I looked at Walter Brennan, and I saw the difference. In Swamp Water, he plays this kind of swamp rat, and someone who's accused of murder, who's really innocent, that the young man, Dana Andrews, gets to know. And I remembered, oh, Walter Brennan from Real McCoys, and this is Walter Brennan, too. And then, in doing biographies, you do the background research, and I couldn't believe there's no biography of Walter Brennan. How could that be? Well, being what I call a serial biographer, I'm always looking for a new subject, not that different from a serial murderer. A librarian once wrote to me, and she said, I want to know, who is your next victim? And it was Walter Brennan, because when I began to look into the range, the 200-plus films, and being in World War I, and like Dana Andrews, spending 10 years in Hollywood, seemingly getting nowhere, to have the guts to stick it out that long and to know you're that good. Walter Brennan always said, this was not a fluke that I was suddenly discovered. I worked for this. I always thought it would happen. I didn't know it would happen this long. You know, he used to say things like, you know, it was tough. We didn't have a lot to eat. He said, I never skipped any meals, although I did postpone some.
So, Carl?
Yeah.
Can you say a few words about how your visit out here and meeting the family changed the nature of your biography?
Sure.
Changed how you told the story.
Before I met David Brewster, and just to tell a little bit more of that story, I was giving a talk at the Philadelphia Athenaeum about Amy Lowell, the poet, one of my other subjects. I call this book on Walter Brennan my New England Trilogy because I did a biography of Sylvia Plath from Massachusetts, Amy Lowell from Massachusetts, and Walter Brennan from Massachusetts. So when I call it my New England Trilogy, I'm sorry to say many audiences no longer remember Walter Brennan. And so the joke falls flat. They don't understand what I mean by a trilogy. Anyway, David Brewster was at the Philadelphia Athenaeum, and I happened to mention that my next book was going to be on Walter Brennan. And he came up afterwards and he said, oh, he said, I know some people who know the Brennans. And this was really great for me, because up until this point, although I could I could look at census records, you know, I could look at Hollywood interviews, I could read books about Spencer Tracy that had a little bit about Walter Brennan in it, books of John Wayne, a little bit about Walter Brennan in it, but I had no connection with the family. It's not that I didn't want to establish a connection. I did find the addresses for Mike and Andy, and I wrote to Mike about a year before I actually came down here, didn't hear anything. And that's when Rich told that part of the story, when I got in touch with Rich. And I think it was Tammy who said to Rich, oh yeah, we got a letter from that Rollison fellow. We get those letters all the time. Which could be done. Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah.
Over the years.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not. That was my Marine Drill Sergeant voice.
Did everybody hear that? Huh? Okay. You're off the hook this time, Tim.
Yeah. What would have been missing from the book would have been about, I think the book is about 100,000 words, maybe a little over 100,000 words. A good 15,000 words would not have been in the book if not for here, for this family. This family really made the biography side of the book. It's not that I didn't have any biographical information, but what would I have said about the ranch? What would I have said about this county? What would I have said about the people here? What would I have said about Walter Brennan walking down the street, stories that Dennis told me, or Peggy told me, or other members of the family told me? All of those stories are in the book. And if you don't have a book, or even if you have a book, you know, it makes a really nice gift. It's really, and especially for people, even for people who don't know Walter Brennan, they should know who Walter Brennan is. Because, you know, he was a great father, he was a great family man. It's a wonderful, Dana Andrews too, is a wonderful Hollywood story, he was a great family man. It's a relief for me as a biographer, no matter how deeply I got into Walter Brennan's life. This is not a fan's biography. It's not that I didn't deal with the dirty secrets. As far as I know, there aren't any dirty secrets. There isn't anything there, that scandal or something, that affairs or something that happened. When derogatory statements were made about women on movie sets, the first thing that Walter Brennan would say is how much he loved his wife, how important his wife was. He didn't say, I don't want to hear that story. If someone cussed on set, he didn't talk about it. I didn't want to hear that language. He would simply come up with a different kind of story. A really telling story that Andy tells. He wrote a little article about his father for a magazine published by the National Cowboy Museum and Western Heritage Museum, in which he talks about on the set of, I think it was Red River, and it was raining, and it was between takes, and everyone scurried into their tents because it was location shooting. And here was John Wayne and Walter Brennan around this campfire. And the rain is coming down, and it's starting to come down harder. And Wayne is talking about, you know, we're going to see who are the real men here. And he, you know, and Walter Brennan is looking at Wayne while his chest is puffed up and talking about what a real man is. And Brennan just looks at him and he said, which way did those guys go? He wasn't into that. He wasn't, you know. His children were not Hollywood children, just like Dana Andrews' children. It was a natural for me to go from Dana Andrews to Walter Brennan. Not that they're, in many ways, they're very different personalities, but in terms of how they felt about Hollywood. Hollywood was a place where work got done, but it's not where you were a star. That's what Walter Brennan liked about here. Rich often says that. What he liked about here is he could just be a person. You know, he wasn't the movie star coming here to, you know, play at being a rancher or something like that. This area meant much more to him than just that. That wasn't a part of it at all. And I read his correspondence with the man who owned Lightning Creek Ranch at the time. I've forgotten the owner's name. Ray Pogue, that's right, Ray Pogue. The correspondence that I found between Ray Pogue and Walter Brennan is all about, you know, are you comfortable about selling this place and how are we going to make arrangements and so on. It was a quite a deliberate, thoughtful choice on Walter Brennan's part when he decided to resettle his family here. Maybe I should stop there, take questions or comments. Who's got the microphone? You do. Okay.
Question about Red River.
Yeah.
Was Red River the movie in which Walter was exchanging teeth with a Chinese cook?
That's right. Yeah. That was a running gag in the movie. Every time he lost in a card game, he would lose his teeth. And there's another film, Support Your Local Sheriff, which also has jokes about the teeth in it. Yeah.
I saw it, Rio Bravo made me think. When did he develop that gimp at his foot, that limp?
That limp was really for the real McCoys. Yeah, that was really for the real McCoys. No, Rio Bravo was 1958. Rio Bravo was shot about a year or two after Rio McCoy started. Yeah. Yeah, sure.
Nope, don't wait. Come on.
I don't have Tammy's voice, so maybe I do this. So my understanding in terms of where the gimp came from was he was in his chair, his director's chair, and he was and it was during the Real McCoys.
Yeah.
And he was called up to do a scene, and he came limping along like that, and he said, this is too much work for an old man, and they loved it.
Yeah.
So it stuck to the series.
Yeah, sounds right. Sounds right. Other questions, comments, corrections, additions?
Did anybody catch him up on anything?
Attacks.
Huh? Now, why would this guy write a biography of Marilyn Monroe?
Hi. In the picture book that, it's cool if everyone looks at it, there's a comment about how he always played older people than he was because of an accident that occurred in 1932 or something.
Uh-huh.
What was that?
Well, there are various versions of what happened, his teeth being knocked out, going all the way back to World War I during a gas attack that he lost some teeth. As a stuntman, he lost some teeth. There was a fight where he lost some teeth. It's a little hard to pin down exactly what happened. There's so many different versions of the story. I do my best to try to, to explain how these stories came about. Yeah.
Well, I thought Mike should say, how do you think he lost his teeth?
Oh, he lost them being mustered in the First World War.
Okay. That was the first story. Yeah.
What was the question?
Wasn't any.
Well, he lost them. He was mustard gas in the First World War, and his teeth is what happened. He lost his teeth. So that's the way he lost them.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't realize this video kept going. That's just fine. It's fine.
When they made Rio Bravo, they told him that it's going to have to put him on a stump, double his leg back and put a stump on it. Oh, he says, I don't need that. He says, you can't walk like that.
Yeah.
So by golly, he walked out of the room, the director and everybody, and he walked out of the room and said, well, boys, how do you like that? He said, that'll do. That'll do.
He was worried. Brennan was worried about the people in West Virginia, that they wouldn't like, that they might think he was making fun of them or something. Just the contrary. They took it as a huge compliment. He got an honorary degree from the state of West Virginia. He went down there. He was honored and feted. The governor came to see him. I mean, just the opposite. They weren't offended at all. Yeah? Yeah. He wasn't a dancer, but he had good moves. I mean, when you see him in that radio dough thing with the coat, I mean, so limber, so flexible. He could certainly do those things. But as far as I know, he wasn't a dancer. You know where you can see him dancing, though, is in a wonderful movie called Rise and Shine. It's with Linda Darnell, George Murphy, screenplay by great screenwriter Herman Mankiewicz. And he plays this 80-year-old octogenarian ex-Confederate officer who has the hots for this younger woman. He rarely got a chance to play that kind of role. And he swings her around the dance floor. He swings around the dance floor and he goes like this. That kind of thing. Although he does it better than I do. And he did not want to do that role. Sam Goldwyn said, you're under contract, you're going to do that role. And after Brennan did, he said, you're right. That was really good. He takes this woman home in a car. He wants to get her, it was the 30s film, you couldn't show this, get her into bed. But he clearly wants to hook up with her. And she says, oh, no, I'm going to bed. She doesn't say I'm going to bed, but it's I want to go home. And he looks around, he says, the night is young. Why not be like the night?
So do all of these Brennan grandchildren and great-grandchildren know how many movies they have to watch in order to know the family lore?
Some of the silence are lost. Some of the films he was in, I couldn't find.
Yeah.
And some I had to go to UCLA in their archive to look at some of these films because they just weren't available anywhere. And I described some of them in the book.
But many are available on DVD.
Oh, many, many are available on DVD. Yeah, at least 40 or 50.
Okay.
Easily.
They made
yeah.
Northwest Passage right over here from McCall, Idaho.
Oh, yes, that's right. Yeah.
The lake and on the river.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He hated that film. They wanted to do a sequel, and Walter said, include me out because he had to, he had to carry this heavy boat up, Rogers Rangers, to avoid the British attack and so on during the French and Indian War. He said, they only had to carry that damn boat up the hill once. He said, we had to do it 12 times.
Were any of the other movies made close to home, Mike? Were any? Was
any other movies here?
Close to here?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Three Godfathers was made out of Red Rock Canyon, out of Mojave, California.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Other?
Here you go.
Yeah.
I just have a comment to make. I'm really thankful that you took this on and have provided us with this information and... We're really thankful for Walter Brennan because he put Joseph on the map, basically.
Yeah.
And he did so much for our community
with
the theater and the motel and all the times he helped with Chief Joseph Days. And it's just, we're really thankful that you've come. And I really appreciate the information.
Thank you, yeah. Yeah. The first film he showed in the movie theater was Curtain Call at Cactus Creek. Now, why this film is not better known, I don't know, because he must have known, as I know. It's a wonderful film. Has Vincent Price in it. Has Donald O'Connor in it. Has Eve Arden in it. I quote some of the dialogue in my book. It has Gail Storm in it. And it's wonderful. And it's a takeoff on his villain role. He plays a bank robber who, I can't remember the Eve Arden's character's name, but he is smitten with her as this stage actress. And he becomes, in Curtain Call at Cactus Creek, Brennan becomes this bank robber who turns into kind of her flunky, who goes around adjusting her dress and, whatever he needs to do to get her on stage. It's just hilarious. He does a send-up in Support Your Local Sheriff, too, when he walks in as the bad guy and Support Your Local, and James Garner's in jail there, sort of cleaning his gun. And Brennan walks over to him menacingly, draws his gun, and James Garner takes out his finger and he puts it in the barrel of the gun.
So, we're winding down a little bit here. I wonder if one of the, Dennis or Tammy or somebody, what's kind of the sequence here? When did the movie theater go in? When did the motel go in? Do you kind of remember that? Or no, you wouldn't remember that. You're too damn and young.
Well, 51 is the motel.
51's the motel?
The movie.
Mom and Dad yeah. Tell you a little funny story about that theater. That some kind of a deal that they take two of them, they get them for one price. So he took the other one and he put the theater in.
Yeah.
And when it was done and completed, everybody come in there and said that had the best acoustics of any place they'd ever been in.
Yeah, it was state of the art what he had there. He had, and in this theater, he had what was called a crying room for families with children. And I went in, it's a Baptist church now, I went in there, that crying room is still there.
Yeah.
So babies, yeah.
I got that Walter was kind of frugal.
He is frugal,
kinda
yeah.
Kind of like Dennis.
He was. He was frugal. Absolutely. And he wanted his family to know the value of a dollar, which is not a bad thing. You know, to grow up knowing what things actually are costing your parents, you know, was I think a good lesson to learn. Ruth sometimes thought that he was a little hard on the kids. She said this in one of the interviews.
Mike got a little bit of that too.
Yeah. Mike's not complaining now. I asked him about it.
Walter made a cripple out of my dad.
What?
I said Walter made a cripple out of my dad. He had to imitate his walk, you know, like he's, you know, not doing good walking, you know, and he had to imitate that to the T.
Well, Angie Dickinson.
He just liked to act like he was.
Yeah. Angie Dickinson swears, she told me this story, that there was a young boy who saw Rio Bravo, and he modeled himself after Stumpy. He turned up with a limp. They took him to the doctor. Nobody could find out what's wrong. He did all kinds of tests and so on. And the kid finally fessed up and said, well, I want to be just like Stumpy.
So there was a question over there, and I know you've covered this, but what's the narrative of Walter's coming to Wallowa County?
Well, Mike knows this too. Mike told me this story. Mike had an ag teacher who had taught in Enterprise, wasn't it?
The ag teacher in Enterprise in 1940 was the FFA teacher. Well, when I went to North Hollywood High School, he'd become the teacher down there. And we got to know him, and then we were going to the
FFA classes, going to, it's called a hog, and we had a little bit of land there in the valley, and so we had a couple of 50-gallon barrels cut open, and we boiled the water and put sticks under it and boiled the water to scald the hog. And so Mr. Smith was there with my dad, and he's talking about getting a ranch someplace, and he told him, he says, you ought to go to Wallowa County. He says, it beats Jackson Hole, Wyoming, all the devil. And so that's how he come up here.
Story I heard, too, was that the first time they came up here, Walter and Ruth, they drove up, I guess, at night. They arrived at night, so they couldn't see anything. And they woke up in the morning, and they saw the mountains. He said, this is the place for us. Yeah.
You got another one, Mike?
What's that?
Another story?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if I have or not. Well, I kind of tell it all the time, like the weather is outside right now.
Yeah.
I had to go over to Pendleton to pick my dad up all the time and coming back. And somebody said, well, Walt, he says, how do you like this over here? Fine, he says, one thing wrong. He says, you only got three seasons there. That's winter, July, and August.
So who flew him? Who picked him up in Pendleton then?
I did.
You did?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
That was about a four-hour trip, too, because there was no freeway or anything.
Okay. Okay.
One over there.
Yeah. Pardon? Well, yeah. We should do that. Should we do it at least by generation? Okay, so Mike, you're the one generation, so you have to stand up. Okay?
Thank you.
Now we need the next generation. So this is grandchildren. Pardon? Yeah? Oh, right. Yeah. From California here. Yeah, Tammy goes there, and these two go with Ruthie. Okay? And then, and Dennis is hiding back there. Okay? Oh, okay. So now, yeah, turn on some lights here. Okay, so now we need The grandchildren. I mean, the great grandchildren. You did. Okay, great grandchildren. And I think we've got a. Charlie, he walked in the door, and I said, his face looks the same as when he played on my Pee-wee baseball team. But at any rate, we have some great-great-grandchildren, right? Stand up. Oh, and here's the other one coming in. So did anybody count how many generations we got there? Five? Five at least? Well, I would invite you all to stick around and visit with each other. And if you have more questions for Carl or Mike, you want to grill him. And if you want to buy a copy of the book, you can. And if you want to get it signed, you can do that. And again, Dennis and Tammy primarily brought in the memorabilia here. And Mike brought in the Cadillac that we're going to auction off. Is that what we're going to do with it? Oh, the door prize, yeah. Do y'all have your tickets?
I wanted that picture over there. The picture right over there, my father on the end, is painted by my brother.
Right. Who is?
Andy Brennan or Walter Brennan.
Walter Brennan Jr., yeah. Andy, known as Andy. Okay.
His middle name was Andy.
Okay, yeah. And there's one other. The plate over there is also done by Andy,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Are there any in the next, those generations, how many actors do we have? Huh? He wants to be? Okay, we got one coming then, okay. Musical theater, really? And where is she? Really? Well, we need to book her here. We get Missoula Children's Theater here. Why? Okay. Well, it's been wonderful having everybody, and I think you're going to enjoy tomorrow, too, 2 o'clock and 7 o'clock. Carl scripted the play out of Walter's words, and then long distance, he and Kevin have been going back and forth on this thing for the last year, right?
Yeah.
And Kevin said he made some changes yesterday. Okay. I guess. What? Yes, we do have some refreshments. And the play, by the way, the play runs what? An hour and 20 minutes? Hour and 20 minutes. Okay. Thank you all very much for coming.